name of the Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Brian Mason, and during this time, I welcome you that we may share together news that has been received on the what God is doing in this world, and to be able to pray upon it and bring the whatever it might be to the one who is upon the throne, and that the Lord Jesus Christ will have the preeminence, the crucified, risen, ascended, and glorified Jesus Christ. The first report that I have read is picked up from the Church Missionary Society, and it's called My Story. And I know it says by Veronica, but apparently this is not her real name. And she is a mission partner based in Europe. And it says, in the mornings, I usually go for a prayer walk by the beach. On one day recently, I met three friendly older men who were out also walking. The following day, as I was returning home, I saw one of the men that I had met the day before. He was gazing at the beautiful sunshine. I greeted him, and he remarked on the beauty of the sky. I said, "Do you know what it reminds me of?" "What?" he asked. I said, "There is a verse in the Bible that says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork." That is from Psalm 19 and verse 1. Judging by his look of surprise, he was obviously not expecting that answer. My response opened up the door for a deep discussion about people, life, and religion. He had many questions because of all the things that are going on in the world now. We spoke about the importance of each of us having a personal relationship with God, and I gently explained how this had been made possible through the death and resurrection of Jesus. I went home and told my family about this man. We prayed and asked God to continue to touch his heart. The following morning, I asked God that if he wanted me to see the man again, to make that arrangement. I was about to return home when I saw him approach. He had more questions. I explained about our need for a Saviour because of our sin, about Jesus being the one who paid for the punishment that we deserve when he died on the cross for us, and how, if we repent and accept that gift and follow him, the Bible says that we have eternal life. The man listened attentively. He said, "How can it be that in all my years I have never heard anything like this?" As we arrived at the end of our walk, he asked, "How can I get into this?" Right there in the street, I invited him to pray with me. And I led him in the prayer of confession and accepting the gift of God and Jesus as his Saviour. We were close to my home, so I asked him to come and meet my family. He was very happy to meet my husband and kids, and we gave him the Gospel of John. The following day, this man was returning to his home city, about 5 hours from us. He asked me if I was going for my walk the following day, and I said that I probably would. The next morning, he was waiting for me. He could not stop saying how perplexed he was about what happened in the last few days. How can this happen without any planning? I told him that God knew that he was ready to receive him. I encouraged him to go to a church when he gets home. I gave him our telephone number and the number of a Christian program where he lives. Please pray for him. We do not just want converts, but disciples of Jesus. I pray often for him, that God will continue leading him in his walk with him. And that wonderful verse that was used by this lady who calls herself Veronica. The heavens declare the glory of God, not the glory of man. And the firmament showeth his handiwork, the glory of God through redemption. Oh, how that message needs to be declared today throughout the whole world, that those who are still in their sins, there's no goodness whatsoever in man. Man is deprived. Man is a sinner in the sight of a holy God. Yet this man, as he said, why had it been so long? He'd become an elderly man, and this was the first time that he'd heard of this wonderful message. Father, our hearts rejoice that this Veronica was able to meet this elderly man and speak to him about whom did she speak? The Lord Jesus Christ. She had to, because there's no other message but the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. And as she met him again, then he saw, yes, that he was a sinner and that there was is a Saviour. And his heart was opened. His heart rather than his mind was opened. That there was revelation by the Holy Spirit to show this man that he was a sinner in the sight of a holy God. And that Jesus had died personally for him at Calvary's cross. Oh, Father, how wonderful it is that redemption is that most important word, as it were, in this world, because without redemption there can be no forgiveness of sin. Jesus redeemed lost, guilty, and already condemned sinners through the atoning blood that he shed at Calvary's cross. Oh, Father, may there be that restoration in these days to preach the Word of God, which calls sinners to repentance. Because what did Jesus speak of? Firstly, to repent. He called sinners to repentance. John the Baptist, too, his first word uttered according to the Bible was repent. And yet, in so much that calls itself Christianity today, it's as though there is been ashamed of calling sinners to repentance. Oh, stir up, O God, afresh, that there will be those, men and women alike, who have been called of thyself because they're in a living relationship with thee, having been forgiven of their sin, to proclaim the glorious gospel of salvation, that sinners will repent and be cleansed through the precious blood of Jesus and receive a pardon and know that their sins have been forgiven, rather than think, I hope they have been forgiven. For this is asked in the name of thy beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and for thy glory and for thy glory alone. Amen. Yes, we're not to be ashamed in these days of making known the glorious gospel. There's been a turning away from that. There's been a centering upon man and man's inherent goodness. There's no inherent goodness in man. He's utterly and completely deprived because of sin. But there is a reluctance to accept that man is sinful and needs a Savior. Yes, when the Spirit, yes, he speaks. Yes, not to be ashamed of the glorious gospel. And this is an email I received from Pastor / Evangelist Blessing, who is in Andhra Pradesh state in India. Just turn to the scripture. Always need to base prayer on the scripture, not the words so much the words of man, but the words of the Holy Spirit flowing using the scriptures. And Pastor Blessing says, "Dear beloved and blessed Reverend Brian Mason, greetings to you in the most fervent name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who shed his blood on the Calvary cross for our sake. Amen." Now where am I going to find something like that in the Western world? Oh, this man probably has very, very little of this world's goods. But yet he has the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit who lived in Jesus, speaking these wonderful words. Such revelation given to this brother. Kindly accept this humble email as an expression of our love and hope for the establishment of heartfelt and fraternal relations among us for the extension of his holy kingdom on the earth. We are so happy to meet you today through web on behalf of our ministry work. I am Pastor Blessing as a faithful bond servant of God. I have been serving our Lord Jesus Christ. We have been presenting our holy Lord Jesus among thousands of people in our area. Aye, that's quite something. Our main intention is not to die anybody without hearing the word of God. Amen. Oh, the God, oh God, that you'll stir up in this Western world too, to be men and women who are so fervent, so not ashamed to make known this glorious gospel. The gospel, which is the person of Jesus Christ himself. We have been serving him among the poor and needy, in rural, remote, and he calls agency areas, among the tribal and downtrodden communities in the villages. To reach the unreached is our motto and goal. To save dying souls in India. My, my, this man. Yes, he's not ashamed of Jesus Christ, no. We are reaching the unreached places, into the highways and byways, spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. Still, there is so much gospel work ahead. We are visiting house to house, schools, colleges, hotels, hospitals, prisons, bus and railway station, distributing the holy gospel literature, frequently publishing by our ministry among the unknown and unsafe people in our remote area. We are proclaiming the gospel of Jesus via outreach, and we are also providing food, shelter for the poorest of the poor children, and helping the poor lepers. It's time. The world is ready. The harvest is ripe. It is time for revival. It is time to reap and time to train the pastors and encourage them. And also, this is time to revive with your powerful, prophetic, and life-changing messages and lessons. In this connection, we are inviting you to hold pastors' conference, stroke seminar, open-air meetings and crusades, or else you come and visit our mission field, our churches and congregations. So we need your prayers and spiritual cooperation to do all gospel and social activities in Andhra Pradesh, India. We have been running a small children's home with parent loss and orphan children. We are giving them free food, free clothes, free medicine, education. So far we are running it with the help of the donations we receive from our church believers. Now as the donors decrease and also the expenses increased this year, that was last year, yet I am facing troubles and hurdles in getting the daily bread and minimum needs for the children of our orphanage. Oh, how many times I hear requests for prayer along these lines. Pray for it and support the poor and orphan children. I am working on faith basis and also living by the small change offering by the poor and needy people, believers, who are attending the churches. I am prayerfully request to you, kindly keep in your prayerful helping hands on me, my ministry, activities, and our ministry co-workers, those who are serving our holy Lord Jesus Christ along with me. So we need your prayers and support to do all these activities in our area with love of Jesus Christ. Isn't it quite something? Yes, he gives Jesus his full name there. This man always had some revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. He actually comes across that Jesus Christ is his life. Yes. please make it convenient to visit our place and witness gospel and social activities. Please pray for my gospel work and the deprived and desolate orphan children, and bless them abundantly in the love of our Lord Jesus Christ through your gifted hands. Your beloved brother in Christ. What? What? Yes, you might say the man, yes, he's coming about certain needs for the children and for the work, but it just comes right out of him that, yes, this is a man who not just knows his God, but God himself in the person of Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit is actually being manifested through this man. Be manifested as Christ amongst those whom he serves, amongst those who he reaches out to. And St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9 and verses 37 and 38. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Heavenly Father, it is thine harvest that Pastor Blessing and all like him, the many ones that you brought me into contact with in India and other parts of the world, that the Holy Spirit is what is burning through him, and the very power of the gospel is being made known to the lost and dying souls in Andhra Pradesh. This man has thy vision to reach the lost. Oh, he is so burdened. And Heavenly Father, oh Father, there are millions, millions who've yet to be given this opportunity to hear of your love for them, that you gave your very best. You spared not your son, that gave him that he would go to the cross of Calvary and through his precious blood make the way whereby sinners, wherever they are, can repent and be forgiven and come to receive the very life of God. Something which, unless those like Pastor Blessing goes out and gives this wonderful message, would die in their sins. Oh, may thine anointing and the Holy Spirit be with Pastor Blessing every day, wherever he goes. And that in the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit, hearts will be opened to receive of thy life in Jesus Christ. And for these dear, dear ones, these children, undoubtedly too there will be widows. And he mentions too lepers. Oh, there are so many needy ones. And he's identified as, along with others who've been in touch, that how it seems that the finances are decreasing and the costs are increasing. O God, O Father, thine honour is at stake. You are the God of the universe, and there's no lack with thyself. May you move upon the hearts of those who have the means of giving to thy work, wherever it be. Open, as it were, the windows of heaven. Open thy treasuries, and that wherever there is a need for thy work, that the need will be met. Not selfish wants, but needs. And that everyone, every day, like these dear children, and the dear lepers and widows, that their needs will be met, not just for the body, not just for the mind, that they will also have the spiritual food of thy word. For this is asked, O Father, through the name which is above all other names, that of thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that you will be glorified through the Son. Amen. Going to continue what I've been covering for a number of weeks now, the ministry plan towards true revival from start 2015 to 2022. Yes, there'll be those who will undoubtedly reject this. But when God has spoken, then we're called to obey. Obey what God is saying rather than what man is saying. It's found in the scripture. I know it's very much given and referring to this ministry, but yet it's actually, it covers the whole world, really, what God has in mind. And this is called the coming together of the open confession movement. That won't go down very well amongst many, many that call themselves Christians, to bring things out into the open. Oh, because what does the evil want to do? He wants to keep things secret. He wants to have secret societies. And the scripture is Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11. And they overcame him. Overcame whom? The devil himself. By the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their lives unto the death. This is true Christianity. Knowing how to overcome by the blood of the Lamb, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and by the word of their testimony. Yes, not ashamed of Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ becomes our very life. And because he becomes our very life, then, as it were, we're dead to that which would stand in the way of him having his way in and through us. It refers to, alongside this, the restoration of the ministry of General Booth. And that wonderful, wonderful hymn he wrote O boundless salvation, the preaching of what? Blood and fire. Not just tickling people's fancies, talking of the things of about the things which are centered upon this world, but the things of God, the things which are in the spirit, things that are spiritual, the things that are the kingdom of God. This stage is going to bring release over the world. Yes, it's to bring release, not just in this ministry, but all over the world. And he refers to Lindsay, yes, part of the ministry here, now has been singing. There is no secret what God can do. So the open confession movement will be bringing about the condition for the secrets which have been many in relation to the sexual revolution of the 1960s, also in relation to the impact of Freemasonry on society, also in relation to the effects of the positive confession movement and its impact in certain parts of the Word of Faith movement, making its form of Christianity into a system of formulas, as with the Sons of Sceva, causing damage to so many. Oh, people won't like this. But God, when Jesus spoke, was he popular? No. Yes, he wasn't popular amongst the religious ones. He spoke of coming to bring division. Spoke of coming not to bring peace. I've not come to bring peace. In amongst it all are so many secrets needing to come out. Man needs to be broken for the power of God to take over. So important. I know what it is to have been broken. And it's been that brokenness. Yes. It's only through brokenness that God can take his rightful place and do what he wants to do through us, in us, through us. Evan Roberts cried out. How many in these days will cry out this? I know I've cried out. Bend me, bind me. God certainly bent him, all right. And how greatly used he was. And the open confession movement, which thou shalt begin, will bring out these opening up. The charlatan preachers, oh dear, nothing here to tittle fancies, calls them charlatans, having no place in this, for their technique, as one has witnessed in England, in particularly, with one particular case where souls are opening up to thee about the suppression that has been upon them. Heavy shepherds have no place in this, with their grandness above everybody else. The charlatan preacher to whom I refer goes on about what he owns and what he has, all the materialism of this world, when my call is not to hoard up treasures on earth, but treasures in heaven. For this movement is all about those who have made themselves poor, who become rich in me. Their passion is to use all their resources for the gospel. And you will have those who lay all their resources at your feet. And your principle of not taking personal offering, but only for the gospel, is one I have noted to your account. for thou as a ministry has been prepared to become poor. So one can have the resource to fulfill the calling on one's life. Thy story, David and Lindsay, on the internet, is to come to the fore. The one you wrote for being 25 years married, the strength of this marriage being in the honesty and openness to each other. Such is to be my church of the open confession, confessing faults one to another, that ye all may be healed. You see, this is a depth of honesty that only comes with a ministry of those who come before me open. No big ministers above everybody else. They too are in this, a place of complete trust. You see, the state has secrets, and thy predecessors, Oxley and Whitehouse, opened them up for all to see. Yet the state suppressed their findings, and little ones suffered as a consequence. The strength of Oxley and Whitehouse was in their openness. The downfall of British constitutional government has been in its secrecy, which you are witnessing now in secret investigations, people living in fear of what is to happen. But thou art overcoming this secrecy. Yes, I will come to the blood of the Lamb, so important in the article of reference to come. But here, in this stage, the word of your testimony is so much more powerful than the operations of secrecy. You see, this operation of secrecy, which has been particularly apparent since the 1960s, with those of the secret agenda infiltrating movements and governments so as to bring control over the people within the activities of the spirit of fear. God has not given thee the spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. And this comes an openness and trust in society. This has been noticed already in government circles in the Conway County. For there is a freedom in this, a liberty which only the spirit can bring. But oh yes, you can tell the people the secrets are to come out. And as they come out, revival comes, impacting all of society, starting with the church. Are my hands clean? Is my heart pure? Just as in the Hebrides, the open confession of the saints brought about revival in the whole of that society. The modern revivals of the charismatic movement being completely opposite to this. So the open confession movement is so powerful, for it brings about empty vessels for the spirit to enter. Prisons can be emptied, hospitals emptied, for this movement takes away the stress, the reason why they are in hospital in the first place. Nations being set free, or are they to continue with the secret agenda of Satan? For the agenda of secrecy, overregulation and fear is what is dominating nations of the world just now. But the open confession movement shall overcome this. It brought about in line with the fulfilling of the vision of General Booth. Oh, bound the salvation, the preaching of blood and fire. Now the article of reference, the preaching of blood and fire, has not being part of this emerging church movement. This has been a concoction of universalism, business technique, heavy suppression over the people, and manifestations of Eastern mysticism, such as Kundalini. It has stolen movement after movement with tolerance of sin rather than conviction of sin. Such is the accommodation gospel. Preaching is seen as too heavy within this movement. But preaching of blood and fire that comes with the open confession movement brings back the important doctrine, as we have in a previous article, of entire sanctification. The boundless salvation preaching of General Booth is to be restored, with the movement of the Salvation Army coming back into the hands of those who preach blood and fire. The Bible College of Wales coming back into the hands of those who preach full surrender. Methodism into the hands of those who preach perfection. The British government into those who administer the Elizabethan settlement rather than the modern laws that have killed innocents, like those in the womb, and the polluting of innocents' minds with immoralities. My word does not tolerate. So we have an open confession movement and the preaching of blood and fire. Well, what was the mourner's bench all about in early days? Or the bench of open confession? And how so many wept on these benches? Where one weeps is immaterial. As long as one weeps. But the open confession brings out deep hurts, and the blood washes them away, and the fire brings about a clean vessel for the Spirit of God to enter in. Such is the preaching of General Booth, and as you write out the words of this hymn, O boundless salvation, in the articles of reference, the mighty ocean of blessing will pour over the people of the open confession movement. What an army you shall have. A salvation army. What a title. What a name. Oh, that is the message of how to reach the people. So this stage is the stage of open confession. You see, when I look at churches commonly today, I see people with fronts, no preaching of blood and fire, but gentle little talks to placate the people in their sins. The open confession movement coming alongside the preaching of blood and fire. What a movement this shall be, for all the secrets shall come out, and my baptism in the Holy Ghost and with fire shall come down upon a people ready to reach every creature with the gospel. What a business plan this is. My business is in reaching every creature with those prepared to pay the price for revival. A revival as I gave through J. Edwin Orr that begins with the searching of God and the open confession of the people. What a message. What an anointing. This is the increasing virtue that comes with the British Constitution, a key for all government departments in Britain to understand, and in America. For secrets bring fear, openness brings liberty. Before I pray on this, I'm very much led to read this wonderful hymn of General Booth. The Holy Spirit undoubtedly gave him these words. They are so based upon the finished work of Christ. So scriptural. And yes, as part of, I know, what will it be now, something like 4 weeks when I did in the program bring about open confession, because I actually openly confessed. And that was the beginning of the open confession movement. So let's see, too, what General Bull wrote. O boundless salvation, deep ocean of love, O fullness of mercy, Christ brought from above, the whole world redeeming, so rich and so free, now flowing for all men, now flowing for all men, now flowing for all men, come, roll over me. My sins, they are many, their stains are so deep, and bitter the tears of remorse that I weep. But useless is weeping, thou great crimson sea, thy waters can cleanse me, thy waters can cleanse me, thy waters can cleanse me, come, roll over me. My tempers are fitful, my passions are strong, they bind my poor soul, and they force me to wrong. Beneath thy blessed billows, deliverance I see. O come, mighty ocean, O come, mighty ocean, O come, mighty ocean, and roll over me. Now tossed with temptation, then haunted with fears, my life has been joyless and useless for years. I feel something better most surely would be if once thy pure waters, if once thy pure waters, if once thy pure waters would roll over me. O ocean of mercy, oft longing I stood on the brink of thy wonderful life-giving flood. Once more I have reached this soul-cleansing sea. I will not go back, I will not go back, I will not go back till it rolls over me. The tide is now flowing, I'm touching the wave, I hear the loud call of the mighty to save. My face growing bolder, delivered I'll be, I plunge neath the waters, I plunge neath the waters, I plunge neath the waters, they roll over me. And now, hallelujah, the rest of my days shall gladly be spent in promoting his praise. Who opened his bosom to pour out this sea? O boundless salvation, of boundless salvation, of boundless salvation for you and for me. Heavenly Father, those words of that hymn are so sacred, coming from the heart of the man, General William Booth, who knew his God. He knew forgiveness of sins. And he knew the Holy Spirit living, working through him in the power of God. And to preach in the Holy Ghost and fire to hell-bound sinners. O God, The open confession movement has commenced. Cause the Holy Spirit to spread, that which is being kept hidden in secret, even amongst those who belong to Christ, will come out in the open. And that which even calls itself Christian and doesn't know this boundless salvation because the blood of Jesus Christ has not cleansed them from sin, because they have not repented of their sins, they've not been born again from above. O Father, thy presence is so, so strong in this prayer. There's a sacredness there, that you have come. You've heard the cry of thy servant to restore the preaching of Jesus Christ and him crucified, resurrected, ascended and glorified, and to bring in that message which has been so neglected and so spurned for years, that message of redemption and the message of union with Christ, a message of being filled with the Holy Ghost and fire, a message of being so filled with the Holy Spirit that the life of the Spirit of God within us is a life which is pure, holy and divine, because God himself in Jesus Christ is able to do that which even before the foundation of the world, to have fellowship with man. A man made us not know his God, but man will know his God living within him in the person of Jesus Christ and the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. For even Jesus said, Father, my Father, I and my Father are one, and we will come and make our abode in you. So sacred is this moment, and thank thee, Father, that in the throne room of God and before the throne, speaking to you as the Holy Spirit gives these words, that it is for thy glory. Thy glory alone. For it is asked in the Lord Jesus Christ's name, that he has the preeminence now. He is the preeminent one. And that you're able to do now all that you have started to do in the open confession movement and bringing true revival which will sweep through the whole world. It is done. Amen. so sacred has this been that I'm going to leave it there. The Lord Himself be given all the glory, that man will not have been seen or heard. Only the Lord Jesus Christ, seen in His preeminence.